serratus anterior and scleri are used when additional respiratory effort is required. And during normal quiet breathing, expiration is usually a passive process when the diaphragm simply relaxes and the elastic recoil of lung, chest wall and abdominal structures compress the lungs and expels the air. And the internal intercostal muscles assist only during forced expiration. And the accessory muscles of expiration like abdominal muscles are used when additional expiratory effort is required. Now, which are the pressures that cause the movement of air in and out of the lungs? These are pleural pressure. Which is a pressure of fluid in the thin space between visceral and parietal pleura, and alveolar pressure, which is the pressure inside of the air inside the alveoli, and the transpulmonary pressure, which is the difference between pleural pressure and alveolar pressure. As you all can see in this diagram, at rest, that is at end expiration, when there is no air flow inside and outside of the lungs, the alveolar pressure is equal to the atmospheric pressure, which we consider as a zero reference point. And the pleural pressure at rest is slightly negative. It is around minus 5 cm of water. This much of suction is required to keep the alveolar open at rest. And the inward elastic recoil pressure and pleural pressure are equal and opposite. The pleural pressure is around minus 5 cm of water. And inward elastic recoil pressure is around plus 5 cm of water. Then during inspiration, when the inspiratory muscles contract and increase the volume of the chest cavity, the pleural pressure decreases from minus 5 to around minus 8 cm of water, and it exceeds the inward elastic recoil pressure and the lungs expand. As the alveolar volume increases, the alveolar pressure decreases than the atmospheric pressure and inflow of air occurs. And the elastic fibers of the lungs are stretched and inward elastic recoil pressure starts increasing, and it increases up to end inspiration till it is again equal to the pleural pressure. And at that time, the alveolar pressure is equal to atmospheric pressure and again air flow ceases. Then during expiration, the diaphragm simply relaxes and the pleural pressure and inward elastic recoil pressure, they come to their resting value of minus 5 and plus 5 cm of water, and the alveolar pressure becomes greater than the atmospheric pressure and air is expelled out of the alveoli. And finally, at end expiration, the alveolar pressure becomes equal to the atmospheric pressure. Then the volume of air inspired by breath depends on the lung compliance. What is lung compliance? It is the change in lung volume for a given change in airway pressure. It is the extent to which the lungs will expand for each unit increase in transpulmonary pressure if enough time is given to reach the equilibrium. The characteristics of compliance diagram are determined by elastic forces of the lungs, which can be divided into two parts: elastic forces of the lung tissue and elastic forces caused by the surface tension of the fluid that lines the inside walls of the alveoli and other lung air spaces. Total compliance of both lungs together in a normal adult man is around 200 ml per cm of water, and the compliance of the lungs and thoracic space together is around 110 ml per cm of water. The monitoring of changes in respiratory compliance is extremely important in ventilated patients, as an early warning of changes in the lung or chest abdominal wall complex that may negatively affect the gas exchange. Out of all these volumes and capacities, the most important for us is the functional residual capacity, which is the volume of air that remains in the lungs at the end of normal expiration. And in a normal adult man, it is around 2.3 liters. It is very important because it is the most important store of oxygen in our body. Now, what is dead space? Dead space can be divided into three parts: anatomical dead space, alveolar dead space, and physiological dead space. Anatomical dead space is the area in which the inspired air does not take part in gas exchange, but it simply fills the respiratory passages. For example, air in the nose, pharynx, and up to first 16 generations of tracheobronchial. Normal anatomical dead space for a 70 kg man is around 150 ml. That is approximately 2 ml per kg. But it is not constant. It will be altered by a number of factors. For example, if the size of the lungs increases, the dead space increases. It also increases in bronchodilation. It decreases in supine posture and in bronchoconstriction. Now, what is alveolar dead space? It is the total number of ventilated alveoli that are unable to take part in gas exchange due to insufficient perfusion. Normally, alveolar dead space is negligible, but it can increase in upright posture, in a low oxygen has reached the alveoli. Down the respiratory tree, oxygen tension is further diluted by alveolar carbon dioxide. The alveolar gas secretion is partial pressure of oxygen in alveoli is equal to partial pressure of oxygen in inspired air minus partial pressure of carbon dioxide in alveoli divided by the respiratory quotient. Respiratory quotient is the ratio of carbon dioxide produced to the oxygen consumed. When we consider only carbohydrate as a substrate, the respiratory quotient is around 0.8, and when we consider proteins or fats as a substrate, the respiratory quotient is 1. If we take respiratory quotient as 1 and we see PaCO2 of 45, the PaO2, that is partial pressure of oxygen in alveoli, it comes around 105 millimeters of mercury. When the oxygen diffuses from alveoli to blood, the diffusion is not qualitative. There is unity in the apical versus basilar perfusion and ventilation. This mismatch is responsible for a slight difference in alveolar and arterial partial pressure of oxygen, which we call alveolar arterial gradient. Normal alveolar arterial gradient at 21% FiO2 is around 5 to 50 millimeters of mercury. And in lung diseases, many lung parenchymal disease, the alveolar arterial gradient increases. Now we cannot measure the alveolar arterial gradient directly. So the other parameter to measure gas transfer defect is PF ratio, which is partial pressure of oxygen in arterial blood divided by FiO2. Normally it is more than 400 millimeters of mercury. And in acute lung injury, less than or equal to 300 millimeters of mercury, and in acute respiratory distress syndrome, it is less than or equal to 200 millimeters of mercury. Now, what are the various factors that affect the oxygen cascade at each level? The factors which affect oxygen cascade from atmosphere to alveoli are, for example, in high altitude or when the water vapor pressure is high, the concentration of oxygen in inspired air itself will be low, so less oxygen will reach the alveoli. Now, what are the factors which affect oxygen concentration in alveoli? Sorry, the partial pressure of oxygen in alveoli. In any condition when the PaCO2 is more, for example, maybe because of greater production in conditions like sepsis or fever or palliative hypertonia, or maybe because of hypoventilation, the partial pressure of oxygen in alveoli increases. Now, the factors which affect the diffusion of oxygen from alveoli to pulmonary capillary blood are ventilation perfusion mismatch. For example, all the ventilated alveoli may not be properly perfused, or all the pulmonary capillary blood may not go through the ventilated alveoli. And other factors affecting are shunting. Shunting is nothing but it is perfusion in excess of ventilation. And another factor is slow diffusion. Now the factors which affect transfer of oxygen from RT to tissue are hemoglobin level, saturation of hemoglobin with oxygen, and cardiac output, and amount of absorbed oxygen. Now, once the oxygen has reached the alveoli, the partial pressure of oxygen, as we have seen, is greater in alveoli as compared to the pulmonary capillary. So, this is the cross section of respiratory membrane. On the left side, it is alveolus, and on the right side, it is the pulmonary capillary. So, there are around 6 layers of the respiratory membrane from left to right. First layer is a layer of fluid containing sulfur plate that lines the alveolus. Second layer is the alveolar epithelium, which is composed of thin epithelial cells. And third is the epithelial basement membrane. Fourth is the thin interstitial space between alveolar epithelium and capillary membrane. Fifth layer is the capillary basement membrane. And sixth is the capillary endothelial membrane. Now, which are the factors that affect the rate of gas diffusion through the respiratory membrane? These are thickness of the membrane, the surface area of the membrane, and for example, diffusion coefficient of the gas in the substance of the membrane. For example, the diffusion coefficient of carbon dioxide is 20 times greater than that of the oxygen, and the partial pressure difference of the gas between the two sides of the membrane. So, according to Fick's law, the gas always diffuses from its high partial pressure to a lower partial pressure. Now, how is oxygen transported in the blood? Oxygen is carried within the circulation from the lungs to the tissues in two forms. First, there is bound to hemoglobin, which accounts for around 98% of oxygen carried by the blood. Each gram of hemoglobin, fully saturated hemoglobin, can bind 1.34 milliliters of oxygen, which is called as a Hoffmann's constant. And the remaining 2% is dissolved in plasma. The volume of oxygen dissolved in plasma is proportional to the partial pressure of oxygen, which is Henry's law. For partial pressure of oxygen. If we put the values of RTD and blood in this equation, RTD and blood, if we take it as 98% saturated and hemoglobin of 50 gram per 100 ml and a PaO2 of 100, the oxygen content comes to be around 20 ml. And if we put the values of a venous blood, which is around 75% saturated and has a PO2 of around 40, the content of venous blood, with the content of oxygen in venous blood will come around 15 ml. Thus, the content of oxygen decreases by around 5 ml from arterial to venous blood. This is the amount of oxygen that is transported from lungs to the tissues by each 100 ml of blood. So, the body of the adult man of around 70 kg contains around 5 liters of blood. So, if we multiply 5 by 50, it will be around 250 ml, which is the minimum oxygen requirement and rest by the normal adult man. So, the final use of oxygen is to produce ATP. So, what will happen if oxygen doesn't reach the cells? All these oxidative pathway will not take place. The pyruvate will only not form, so there will not be a further pathway. The anaerobic metabolism will take over and glucose will be converted to lactic acid, which will lead to metabolic acidosis and which will finally lead to cell death. We don't want all this to occur, that's why we want to prevent hypoxia and we supplement oxygen in hypoxia. What are the body's oxygen stores compared with its consumption? In addition to oxygen in the lungs, that is around 500 ml within the FRC, oxygen is stored in the blood, which is dissolved in plasma and bound to hemoglobin, which is around 700 to 800 ml of oxygen in 5 liters of blood. And around 250 ml is bound to hemoglobin in the muscles. And around 250 ml of oxygen is bound to myoglobin in muscles. So this gives a total of around 1550 ml of oxygen. In an adult man, the minimum oxygen consumption at rest is around 250 ml of oxygen per minute. So if you divide 1550 by 250, it will come around 6 minutes. All these parameters are of the normal adult man. All these, the content of oxygen in blood, in FRC, all this varies from person to person. For example, in patients with obesity, pregnancy, or type 2 scoliosis, the FRC will be low. So there will be low oxygen store. And for example, if the hemoglobin is low, the oxygen carrying capacity will also be low. So there is a term called partial point, which is a critical PO2, through which oxygen delivery is unable to meet the tissue demands. And after that, anaerobic metabolism starts, which is around 1 to 2 millimeters of mercury in microperfume. And so all this means that apnea needs to occur only for a few minutes before the onset of significant cellular hypoxia. To prevent this hypoxia, we deoxygenate patients before inducing the apnea with muscle relaxants. Now, in brief, we will discuss about the oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve. As you all see in this diagram, this curve depicts the relationship between partial pressure of oxygen, which is plotted on the x-axis, and the saturation of hemoglobin with oxygen, which is plotted on the y-axis. So as you all can see, the curve is not linear, it is sigmoid in shape. So why it is sigmoid in shape? It is because of the cooperative binding. Cooperative binding means increasing affinity of hemoglobin for oxygen with each successive oxygen binding. That is, when the first molecule of hemoglobin binds, it has to bind with a relative difficulty. It has to overcome the electrostatic charges, and at that time the globin molecules are far apart, which we call the tense configuration. But once the first molecule of hemoglobin has bound, it is easier for the next molecule to bind. So the fourth molecule binds approximately 300 times more easily than the first molecule of oxygen. So as you all see in this part, first the graph is steep, and when the oxygen saturation reaches around 90%, the graph relatively becomes flat. So to attain a saturation of around 90%, we need a PO2 of around 60 millimeters of mercury. That is why we need a minimum PO2 of 60 millimeters of mercury to maintain a saturation of about 90 and above. Another term we need to discuss is P50. P50 is the saturation of hemoglobin with oxygen. P50 is the saturation of PO2 at which the hemoglobin will be 50% saturated. So when we see here, the hemoglobin is 50% saturated at the PO2 of around 27 millimeters of mercury. So at normal body temperature of 37 degrees Celsius, the PO2 will be around 27 millimeters of mercury. But whenever there is any condition, which whenever there is increased offloading of oxygen is required, or there is decreased activity of hemoglobin for oxygen, the P50 will be attained at a higher PO2. So the oxyhemoglobin dissociation, so the P50 will shift towards right side, and oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve will shift towards right. And whenever there is a condition, when there is a decreased speed of oxygen, or when the affinity of hemoglobin for oxygen is more, the P50 will attain, the P50 will be attained at the lower PO2. So the P50 will shift towards left side, and the oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve will shift towards left side. Now, which are the conditions which cause the shift of oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve? The factors, as I have already told, the factors which shift the oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve to right side, which are the conditions which decreases the activity of hemoglobin for oxygen. For example, increased carbon dioxide production, for example, in sepsis, in the management of hypothermia, or whenever there is hyperthermia, in anaerobic metabolism, when the 2,3-DPG levels are increased, or in acidosis, and in sickle cell disease, and during exercise. Now, factors which shift, whichever factor that increases the affinity of hemoglobin for oxygen, it can shift the oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve towards left side. These conditions are decreased CO2 production, in hypothermia, decreased 2,3-DPG levels, and acidosis in minimum globulinemia, in carbon monoxide poisoning, and in hemoglobin F. Because hemoglobin F is present in fetus, it has to extract oxygen from the mother's blood. So it has a higher affinity for oxygen. So thank you so much for your presentation. Next lecture.
Find out the alveolar cause, you will have to do CT scan or a chest X-ray. if you want to do a if you want to find out the airway disease cause, you will have to do PFTs, and if you want to find out the vascular causes, you will have to do CT angiogram. So here in BQ mismatch, 90% of the time the cause is BQ mismatch. Why hypoxemia occurs? So first is airway diseases, either asthma or COPD, vascular diseases like pulmonary embolism, and alveolar diseases like pneumonia, pulmonary edema. So why it occurs? It basically occurs due to the poor aeration of the areas of the lung due to abnormalities of gaseous exchange. And there is hypoxic vasoconstriction, because of which this BQ mismatch occurs and hypoxemia sets in. Then it can be due to hypoventilation. Either the patient is not taking proper tidal volume, or patient is not the respiratory rate of patient is not good. So it can be due to opioids, excessive sedation, coma, hypoTSH. Also in obesity, like the syndrome which we have mentioned, many of you who have given RR in recent times might be remembering one patient. She was operated for lower limb debridement in septic and was shifted. Then the other residents are not here. So she was requiring permanent long-term oxygen therapy at home. So this was the cause, because she was hypoventilating. So because of this, sometimes long-term oxygen therapy be required.
Morbidly
obese. And in kyphoscoliosis or neuromuscular diseases also, hypoventilation sets in. And when there is increased death space, when the asthma or COPD are in advanced stages of its then hypoventilation can be an issue. Then shunts, there can be vascular shunts or intracardiac shunts like mentioned, and there can be alveolar shunts, which occurs in cases of severe pneumonia, ARDS or pulmonary edema. Then there can be diffusion issues like interstitial lung diseases, various interstitial lung diseases are there. So and pulmonary artery hypertension, all that can lead to diffusion issues, which were very nicely explained by Shubhangi in the previous text. So I won't go into the detail. And let me ask you a few questions before we proceed. What was the normal age rating which Shubhangi just mentioned in his previous text?
5 to 15.
Okay, so there's a chocolate for you. So whosoever will answer question, this is to motivate you all guys to keep interacting with us. So next, so what this in this age rating, we saw that the atmospheric pressure plays an important role. So as she mentioned that in certain cases it becomes high, like in high altitude there is low atmospheric pressure, because of which oxygen therapy might be a requirement and hypoxemia might occur. So now hypoxia, what is hypoxia? When there is when the oxygen supplies are insufficient to meet oxygen demands in a particular compartment or tissue. So there are four basic causes of hypoxia. There are four basic types of hypoxia. Either it can be hypoxemic hypoxia, all the causes of hypoxemia can lead to hypoxemic hypoxia. Then we have anemic hypoxia, where actually the hemoglobin is not there. Even if we are giving oxygen, the less amount of hemoglobin will get saturated and hypoxia can set in. And it can also be caused due to CO poisoning, which can also lead to anemic hypoxia. Then there is stagnant hypoxia, when there is low cardiac output, cold extremities, gangrenous extremities are there, or vasoconstriction is there existing. So the tissue won't receive the oxygen even if you are supplying the oxygen. Then at last there is dystoxic hypoxia. Very peculiar example is there cyanide poisoning, where there is dysfunction in the normal cellular metabolism. Also, let me ask you, in sepsis, even if we are giving oxygen, why there are low PO2 levels? This is a very important word which can be asked as an MCQ to you all. Cytopathic dysoxia. The mitochondrial function is affected in sepsis, because of which even if we give CO2, even if we give O2, the oxygen is not getting utilized by the tissues. Then a basic difference. What is hypoxemia? These are caused due to low partial pressure of oxygen in the blood, and hypoxia, low O2 supply to the tissue. Then hypoxemia can be directly measured, but exactly when there is tissue hypoxia, like in cases of sepsis, we can't measure where exactly it is happening. And hypoxemia is a sign of cardiopulmonary disease, while hypoxia occurs in organ dysfunction cases, MORTS and sepsis and other cases. So basically, according to the guidance of ISA and American College of Chest Physician and National Heart and Lung and Blood Institute, I have summarized all the indications of oxygen therapy, taking into account all the causes of hypoxemia and hypoxia where we require. There can be in cases of acute and chronic hypoxemia, then hypoxia, myocardial ischemia, low cardiac output, chronic type 2 respiratory failure, ARDS, respiratory distress, hypotension, acute GI, CO poisoning. So all these we have already covered. I've just summarized them. Then there are perioperative indications where we have to give oxygen therapy. What are they? Patient factors, like ma'am said, morbid obesity is there, shifting is there, cardiorespiratory distress is there. In major surgeries, like in CBPIs, we have observed that we don't extubate the patient at least for one day when we have actually operated open heart surgery is done. So in major surgeries, we don't wean off the patient so easily. Then hypovolemia or hypotension, we require oxygen therapy. And along with the post-operative analgesics, like I mentioned, hypoventilation sets in along with the excessive ventilation. So that is why we have to give oxygen therapy. Then after all this, I would like to ask residents over there, which will be the easiest hypoxemia to treat of all those which I have mentioned? Even if you answer broadly, you will get a job. I will give 5 seconds, otherwise we will have to rest.
Hypoxemia.
Which are the causes of hypoxemia?
There were 5 causes, if you remember. Just tell me which cause is easiest to treat of those 5 causes.
Hypoventilation.
Wrong. One more chance, otherwise you will get into GQ mismatch. GQ mismatch is the cause. Which is easiest to treat amongst hypoxia? Okay, amongst hypoxia, in which oxygen therapy, I have mentioned this in my presentation also, where oxygen therapy is less effective, not so effective. Yeah. So who has answered? Shrikant. Then will oxygen therapy help in pure sense? And if yes, then why? If no, then why? All those shanks which I have mentioned are incomplete shanks, like ASVP. Pure complete shanks will oxygen therapy help? Okay, let's proceed. So here are the answers. Hypoxemia due to VQ mismatch is easiest to treat amongst all the causes. Then oxygen therapy is less effective in case of tissue hypoxia, which was rightly mentioned, cytotoxic, and also in cases of carbon monoxide poisoning. Apart from cytopathic dysoxia. And oxygen therapy is ineffective in when there is a pure shunt, such as in cases of pulmonary AVM. Here, where there is mixed venous duct and it does not pass through the alveolar capillary unit. So, there will be only a small increase in PaO2 in dissolved oxygen. So, this is very small as compared to the content of oxygen which is being carried by the hemoglobin over there. Okay? So, this you will have to remember.
Go back to the causes of VQ mismatch.
First, when we are in initial stages of our residency, we disconnect the oxygen. So they come and tell us this patient is having pneumothorax, how have you disconnected the oxygen? Or sometimes you might have observed when there is pneumocephalus in CP pain. They tell us yes, you have to give oxygen therapy because there are some beneficial effects of it. And also in cluster type of headache, oxygen therapy, hyperoxemia is of benefit. So again, this question is related to risk. A 50-year-old male patient who is a chronic smoker who was started on POMT ACE therapy, chemotherapy for his testicular cancer, he had a history of chronic CO2 retention. So can we give him oxygen therapy, and if not, then why? What is the reason? Just note two things. He is on which chemotherapy and CO2 retention is there. This is this question you won't find on that. I have made it myself. Anyone? Yes?
Since they are dependent on oxygen for their ventilation, when we give oxygen therapy, then hypoxic drive gets suppressed.
So that is true. Half answer is correct. Half is remaining. Okay, no issues. We will give you protein back. Then the reason, coming to the reason, here patient, she rightly said, if we will give oxygen therapy, it will decrease the respiratory drive. Okay, but here the patient was also on bleomycin chemotherapy. If you are with this, so in such cases, if you give oxygen therapy, pulmonary toxicity can occur. It can lead to pulmonary fibrosis and emphysema second. So in such patient and also in patient who has ingested paraquat or acid, we avoid oxygen therapy because it ultimately will be harmful. So there are some physiological risks associated. If you give more oxygen, worsen VQ mismatch can occur, absorption multiplexes, reduced cardiac output can occur, damage from oxygen free radicals and increased systemic vascular risk. All these risks I will discuss in detail later. Then there are certain clinical risks associated with oxygen therapy. So if uncontrolled oxygen therapy is given, so the hypercapnic respiratory drive, as you said, that will set in. There are certain toxicity which we combine and tell as oxygen radical disease in neonatology. So there are four spectrums which comes under the umbrella of oxygen radical disease in neonatology. First is bronchopulmonary dysplasia, then we have ROP, retinopathy of prematurity, necrotizing enterocolitis, and patent ductus spartidosis. So all this can set it if you give excessive oxygen in neonates also. Here is the reference. Then you might have noticed whenever cardiac arrest sets in, it is generally said that oxygen therapy should not be used without checking, meaning should not be used for overuse. So why it is there? Because high concentration in oxygen therapy produces hyperoxemia, and it has been associated with increased risk of death in such patients, in survivors of cardiac arrest patients. So you should use oxygen only when it is required in such patients. So coming to the classification of oxygen therapy devices. So this is the broad classification and one of the important classifications. Either it can be low flow or variable performance devices can be there, or high flow or fixed performance devices can be there. So examples are written over here, but we will discuss each example briefly. Based on dependency also, you can classify oxygen therapy devices. Either it can be patient independent or patient dependent. And in patient dependent, there are three major classifications: low dependency, medium dependency, and high dependency. So based on the capacity, either it can be no capacity, low capacity, medium capacity, or high capacity. So low dependency are again divided into low flow systems and high flow systems. High flow systems are generally fixed kind of oxygen therapy devices, and low flow systems are here as mentioned, nasal cannula, simple mask, reservoir mask. So we will discuss the low flow or variable performance devices in detail. FiO2 depends on the patient. Here FiO2 is variable. Why? I will explain you with the help of diagram. We are giving O2 in a fixed FiO2. the fresh air gas flow is fixed here. But then when patient inspires, the air comes from the atmosphere and it is entrapped with it. It is called air entrainment after the oxygen therapy devices are used. So the force with which and the volume which the patient will consume will decide how much amount of air is getting entrained along with the fresh gas flow. So if it is if the rate of the patient, respiratory rate of the patient is more, or if he is taking a deep breath, so FiO2 is fixed, but the air is getting entrained in a higher proportion. So the FiO2 which is getting delivered to the patient is in the low. So we have to summarize that when there is slow and shallow breathing, high FiO2 is delivered, and fast and deep breathing, low FiO2 is delivered. So first is nasal cannula, which is most commonly used when in PO cases also, as well as post-op cases. It is most commonly used device for oxygen therapy. Flow rate varies from adult to pediatric patients and to neonate patients. In adult, we can keep it as from 0 to 6. Above 4, people suggest that we should not keep because it causes irritation and the resistance inside the oxygen tubing is very much. So according to our protocols, it should be 0 to 4. Then in neonates, it should be 0.25 to 1 meter only. And 1 liter is the maximum. It is kind of high flow system to the neonates. So we should not use at 1 liter. And this is nasal cannula I'm talking. Oxygen hood is a different thing. And flow rate for pediatric patient is 0 to 4. Then advantages we all know that it is inexpensive. The eating and other things for the patient becomes easier. So it is an easy to use device and inexpensive device. So whenever low amount of oxygen is required, so we can use these. Then disadvantage is local irritation is there in case the humidification is not proper. So just remember this, you have to add 1 meter in this. This is very important for all the residents because it is generally asked that at this much liter per minute, how much FiO2 will get delivered. So 24, you just have to add 4% every time and 1 liter in this side. Then this is something new which we haven't and we are not using in our institute. This is a nasal catheter. It is a kind of invasive thing. That is why we avoid using it. Here the cannula directly reaches the pharynx. So advantage is again the stability part. Like if you have noticed, when we put RT in patients and we apply nasal cannula, it generally gets getting disconnected or O2 is not given properly. So in such cases, we can use nasal catheter. Then disadvantage is difficult to insert, high flow increases back pressure and other things. Then simple face mask, it is the most common device used in post-operative phase. So here also the capacity of that mask is around 100 to 300 ml and flow we can keep from 3 liters to 8 liters and FiO2 of 35 to 50% is delivered. Advantage is it is quick and easy to use, it provides epistaxis and irritation caused by nasal cannula. And it is useful in strict mouth breathers where they are not using those, so nasal cannula is hardly of any use. Disadvantage is it causes re-breathing and it is generally disconnect when the CO2 levels comes in on a so at this particular liters per minute, FiO2 is just getting delivered. So tracheostomy mask, again this is a new thing for us. So 3 to 4 liters we can keep the flow and FiO2 delivery same as the Hudson's mask which I have mentioned in the previous video. Again this is oxymineser. So sometimes nasal cannula comes with reservoir models with it. So pendant model is there, Mushnak model is there. So FiO2 of 80% can be delivered using nasal cannulas with reservoir system. Coming to the NRPA mask, which we generally use. So FiO2 depends on the flow rate as mentioned earlier. And it is a variable performance device and it avoids dry gas complications because we generally provide a humidified oxygen to it. And there is a reservoir in it. So it is a modification of simple mask and flow rate for adults is from 10 to 15 liters and FiO2 up to 90% can be delivered. While in pediatric patients, up to 5 liters we can keep. And there is no mix mixing or more air entering inside it. That is because of presence of wall, entrainment of air is prevented, which is an important thing in such kind of device. So these are few slides showing how it is there. You all know about it. Then in cases of neonates and infants, enclosure systems are used, either oxygen bulb or oxygen tanks. Both of these can be used. So here you have to look after that. The hood is should be enclosed completely. Otherwise, your FiO2 targets won't be achieved. So 10 to 50 liters, 80 to 90% FiO2 can be delivered. And in cases of tents, there are soda line also we can apply over there to remove the CO2 and calcium chloride. Now there are certain limitations. FiO2 varies and temperature regulation is required, especially in cases of tanks, because otherwise the baby will land into hyperthermia when tanks are made up of plastic. And skin irritation is there because of oxygen in cases of neonates. So just to show you all what are tanks and hoods. Then coming to the last topic, high flow or fixed performance devices. It provides fixed FiO2, and but again, if the functioning of the device is not correct, so false FiO2 will be provided. And patient's inspiratory demand should not exceed the device output. Like if you are setting a particular FI and patient is requiring FI more than it, so he will be it will affect the proper functioning of the device. So the Venturi mask, which we all know and use, it is based on Bernoulli's principle. So what is Bernoulli's principle? Anyone? No issues. Till that time, I will go through the slide. You can think on it. So Venturi is a simple design valve which connects to the mask and uses high flow oxygen and provides a fixed FiO2 to the patient. And it is most commonly used in COPD cases and also used in weaning of a patient when you require a particular FiO2 for the weaning of a patient. So anyone, Bernoulli principle or shall I proceed? So it is relation between the velocity and pressure. So in brief, I will tell you, the mechanical energy should be conserved according to Bernoulli's principle, because of which if velocity is high, the pressure increases. So in cases of Venturi meter, the air is flowing with high velocity through a constricted pathway, and where here at this point where the constrictor ends, the pressure becomes negative, because of which air is entering, and depending on the holes which it is having Venturi mask, fixed amount of air is allowed to enter in and the fixed FiO2 is delivered. So here is the design and Venturi mask. So I have a mnemonic for you all by which you can remember the FiO2s. By the way, all of you are watches. Okay. So fixed FiO2 is delivered in each case. There are multi-vent mask in which the green and white vents are connected, and we can change it to decide when you want in the same patient. You want this FiO2 for some duration, this FiO2 for some duration. You can just switch it other direction. So here is the photo, and these are the FiO2s delivered. Then there are aqua bags also. This is now in currently not in use. And coming to the most important topic, non-invasive ventilation, which we had used very rigorously in COVID. So there are various modes: CPAP, PS, BiCAP, KVAP. There is provision of ventilatory supports to the patient's upper airway. Invasive ventilation, we bypass everything. We bypass the upper airway and directly deliver oxygen in the lower airway, below the vocal cords. But here we deliver the oxygen through upper airway. And this is a newer method. Coming to the history, it was basically when invasive ventilation became a problem, especially in pediatric patients. Scientists thought of this kind of ventilation, and non-invasive ventilation was developed. Okay, so a few photos to depict non-invasive ventilation. Now coming to the first part of it, only to, where we will discuss BiPAP and CPAP briefly in one slide. There is a constant pressure which is maintained. There is a constant pressure. Suppose this is inspiration, expiration. So there is a constant pressure maintained on the lower limit. So even if patient is expiring, this much pressure is there, like in the alveoli. So what it helps in, it helps in decreasing the thoracic, it increases the thoracic pressure. So ultimately, the cardiac output is decreased. Also, it helps in increasing the alveolar recruitment. Whenever a constant pressure is there, even at the expiratory end, alveoli don't collapse. And hence, it is useful in type 1 respiratory failure, especially in CHF cases and obstructive sleep apnea. In this, ventilation is happening without CPAP. So you can see that the lungs are getting completely collapsed without the CPAP. Now, in upcoming few moments, we will attach CPAP to it. Now, what will happen? The CPAP, when it is getting connected, the amount of alveolar recruitment will increase, and even during expiration, the lungs won't collapse. So this is the importance of CPAP. So coming to bilevel positive airway pressure, when you give apart from this expiratory end pressure, which is known in EPAP as well, expiratory positive end pressure, if you give inspiratory pressure, which helps in taking a sustainable amount of tidal volume, so that is what IPAP. And the difference between two is pressure difference, and this pressure difference decides the tidal volume which will get delivered to our patient. So EPAP you can keep zero also, depending on your patient's condition, because already a physiological peep is there in a patient. And IPAP you can again keep from 5 to 25. But then over 20, it will increase risk of complications. And it is useful in COPD patients, heart failure patients again, if heart failure patients are of severe, increased severity. So APAP is a newer modification in which pressure support is adjusted to get you set a particular tidal volume, and through a feedback mechanism, the machine itself changes the pressure support and a fixed tidal volume is delivered. So when to switch from NIV, when the hypoxemia or hypercapnia is not getting resolved, nausea or vomiting is there, aspiration chances are increased, continuous exertion, accessory muscles are being used by the patient, or poor GCS is there. So in a nutshell, I have covered this slide. When a room at 21%, on NC you can deliver up to 40%, then on venturi up to 50%, oximizer up to 80%, and NRP and HFNC, BiPAP and mechanical ventilation 100%. Can deliver. So these are the uses which we have already covered. This is trying to just to summarize. Thank you.
Mechanical ventilation and non-invasive ventilation. So your CPAP, your BiPAP, and And your third is your HFNC. So your next is a high flow nasal cannula. Something else you have missed? No. So basically NIV, everybody has used NIV non-invasive. Now in COVID you must have used NIV like anywhere, right? In every ICU you have used. So the main is CPAP. Whenever we put NIV on hypoxemic finger, you want CPAP, right? You want pressure support and CPAP to your patients who are breathing. And what the CPAP does, it not only inflates the alveolar, which allows for more time, there is continuous exchange happening, because the alveoli don't shut during inspiration. They keep it open and there will be continuous diffusion happening, and that's how your oxygenation will improve. But also in congestive heart failure, this CPAP effect kind of pushes the fluid out also. So it's double effect. Okay? So NIV is very good in patients who got fluid in the lungs. Right? CPAP, NIV is very good. And when do you use BiPAP, IPAP and EPAP? When patients are having COPD. Okay? The sick COPD or respiratory. Whenever you have a patient who not only hypoxemic but also hypercapnic, then only CPAP mode will not work. You have to have a dual mode. So either you have a more pressure support added to your CPAP, or it is more IPAP added to your EPAP. And this difference in I and E will give you some tidal volume which can be generated, and it will help in expiration and prevent that stacking of breaths that may happen on the water. You know? So it basically allows for exhalation, and hence it is more useful in hypercapnic respiratory. Now, high flow nasal cannula is another important thing which you should know.
Or NRDM also delivers oxygen tender allow the 0.212, 100% FiO2, and at the flow rate of this is a 4 liter, which is set, can set up to 60 liter per minute of flows. Then gas is heated and humidified in this humidifier, and it is given to the patient through this inspiratory circuit, and this is the nasal cannula.
Tidal volume into respiratory rate.
Yes, tidal volume
into
respiratory
rate.
500
is
the
tidal
volume and 20 is the respiratory rate.
In
normal ventilation patient, the minute ventilation.
10 liters.
Now peak inspiratory flow is 3 times the minute ventilation. How much will it be?
30 liters per minute. Irritation and crusting won't happen with the humidified air, but in normal nasal cannula it's a dry air, dry oxygen which is delivered, so irritation and drying will happen.
Thank you.
150 ml anatomical dead space.
See, another basic difference is NIV gives you positive pressure ventilation. What is HFNC? It's totally depending on the patient's spontaneous breath.
This
is just high flow, and this very high unified flow, the patient gets oxygenated by the very physiology of eliminating the dead space, okay, which decreases the work of breathing and gives a fixed FRO. So these are the two main aspects by which it works. One, it eliminates any dead space which is there, and second, there is a fixed FRO2 which we can deliver. And in spite of using such high flows, there is the humidified and warm air oxygen going to the patient. So all these benefits work in giving us the right oxygenation to the patient. Whereas NIV there is a positive pressure delivered to the patient, and you require an interface in the form of a mask or a cannula or a nasal mask or whatever it is. Yeah, and the patient has to accept it. And HFNC is more accepting to the patient. It is very easy. He can eat, drink, talk, and the saturation is maintained. While NIV becomes very cumbersome for the patient. Imagine a positive glow coming on to you the whole time. So they don't tolerate more than 4 hours. After that, they really want a break. So you can give a break with HFNC or an ambient, and then again. You cannot put 20, like if you've seen your COVID patients, if you have to give 24 hours NIV, they require sedation. Nobody can tolerate continuous glow onto their face, even if you keep it minimum. And if you keep increasing your CPAP and your IPAP levels, what will happen? What is the effect of increasing those pressures? Ultimately, it may cause cardiac instability. There will be hemodynamic patients will be affected. If you keep on increasing, can I have a CPAP more than 25-30? You will have bowel trauma, you will have water trauma also, and you will have arrest patient also. So there is a restriction. But here, I can use very high flows. And anyway, but there are some problems with HFNC also.
Amount of air residing in the lungs, amount of
volume of air remaining in the lung after NP end of normal expiration. So it increases the functional residual capacity, usually 25-25%. So all these
measures you do after. If after collecting also there is persistent high respiratory rate, there is ongoing hypoxemia, this crack abdominal or syndrome, which is not permanently organ failure, persistent hemodynamic instability, inclined pelvic syndrome. Basically, if parameters are not improving with the HFMC, then there is no point in going ahead more with the HFMC, right?
Difficult intubation.
Just the indication. Now, this is the passive
only denitrogenation.
There's no.
Because of lack of ventilation, we are giving oxygen. Oxygenation is happening, but ventilation is not. What is ventilation? Is oxygenation and ventilation.
Exchange of gas.
The rate of rise of CO2 giving apnea
require distilled water all the time. Second, the nasal cannula is very soft. Okay. If it gets obstructed or pinched, then the flow will stop immediately. So you have to be very careful about your alarms, because you will put HFNC and go away, and they'll keep alarming. Everybody will think it's delivered. It doesn't stop delivering. You only realize it when it desaturates. So that nasal cannula tip is very soft, and you have to make sure that it's not obstructing. Even if it's slightly kinked, it will stop giving that high flow, and then the patient will start desaturating. Yeah. Who remembers the full form of TRIPE?
Transnasal Rapid
Insufflation
Ventilation.
So TRIPE is a company name. So what we have is a, in SOT, what do we have? What is the company name?
Airway.
So it's now, what we are using is basically all the principles of high flow nasal cannula. Right? Everybody knows how to adjust the FiO2, how to play around with the switches, because all that video we have not put. Everyone knows how to use an HFNC. What is the maximum peak flow when you set it in the HFNC? When you set adult pediatric, pediatric mode, the maximum flow kitna rehta hai?
7 liters.
7 liters nahi hai, it's up to 30 liters. Okay, you can adjust, and the maximum pediatric, when you press it, when you go to start button, there is pediatric and there is optional. But when you are doing pediatric, it has to have a pediatric nasal cannula. Okay? Pediatric HFNC, so maybe you will have to read it or get back to me if you want to know about pediatric HFNC.
Decreased affinity.
Huh? When does it decrease the affinity for oxygen and
hemoglobin?
When does that happen?
Thank you. and it's just going to be a example of that. So let the compensation of the use to be the density of the back. Oxygen over the absorbs more infra light, that is around 948 nanometer, and the oxygen over the absorbs more of red light, that is 660 nanometer. The ratio of this absorption of red and infra light wavelength to sunlight rays is more like 1.3. So it is important to ensure that the oxygen has a distinction and drop may be quite a lot of different units of cost from the UCP thereof to take the rest available treatment for the user. And availability of the process features may be different of the cycle when it is different and actually for the PC for vibrant cycle. And for microwave components, we have the appropriate cycle of the nutrition for children, the specific type of the type. That is for the aggregate blood flow, one and two, the disease. Then about size, this is to the loading of the microwave integration, the pickups, the stuff. And you should ensure that the digit is inserted fully to the form. The units and the detectors must focus one another and the light should not bypass the digit, reaching that to the digit. Then the screen length should be taken for at least 10 or 5 minutes and we can for a 4,000 change of size is added. Pulse of signals are most unreliable in the new homes as because the minor stages. The advantages of pulse oximeters are exactly but when we have the accuracy of pulse oximeter determines the CO2 response below 8 months. Other advantages are fast response time, it's non-invasive, so it gives a quantity of pressure, it's lightweight and compact. So it's a the limitations are, it gives no information regarding pH, PCO2, or CO2. And accuracy is diminished in patients with different diseases like hypoxia. And the accuracy of the oximetry is unreliable in presence of carbon monoxide or oxygen. Because both of these substances have a light absorption, which is similar to oxygen. And then skin pigmentation in main polish have things like acne or oxygen. ABT provides an assessment of the body process is oxygenation by PaO2 values. It is the amount of oxygen stored in the blood and therefore it provides the initial information on the efficacy of oxygenation. Then ventilation, by the PaCO2, the increase of fermentation is inversely proportional to the PaCO2, so that the ventilation increases, the PaCO2 increases, and oxygen. And then the acid base status. A plasma pH of
specific wavelength of near infrared and near infrared.
value ranges from 55 to 75%. And it's mainly used in dramatic cases of several hospital patients, which occurs in several embolic, cardiac, or severe
patients. Where do we use it?
Cardiac.
In all CV bypass patients, all major chest injuries and all elevations in both the wall and bypass, we can use the cerebral oxygen.
So, it's a venous isolation. It is ideal question to be, it's a venous blood in the pulmonary artery. So,
what does mixed venous oxygen saturation tell us? Information about what? What is normal SpO2? Where do you get this? In which laboratory investigation of ours? SpO2? In the recovery? You get this on EBG?
Yep.
No. Get it on?
Pulmonary artery.
Your EBG actually. Itna baar main bol rahi hu EBG low because I want to look at this SpO2. What information it gives SpO2? Oxygen delivery at the tissue level. Okay. So when that SpO2 is falling to less than 55, we know that patient is hypoxic. Yes.
Is in
shock. We have to do something about it, either give it fluid or blood or increase the cardiac output by vasopressors. Okay, so it gives you a trend if the patient is coming out of that hypoxia or no. Huh? Mixed venous you get from PA. Okay. Central venous is going to get from our central
lines. So now, if you do mixed venous saturation, it's usually 2-3% normal than the SpO2. And normal values usually over 1.6. Then it comes to the near infrared, essentially non-invasive method of combination with the saturation in the tissues using the optical properties of hemoglobin oxygen and as well as the main feature of this NERs is responding to 130 microamperes.
Any monitor has it? Neuro ka monitor has it?
Thank you. carbon monoxide poisoning, the standard construction will be kind of screened from the carbon monoxide exposure because it does not differentiate between carbon hemoglobin as well as oxygen hemoglobin. Because both of them have a similar absorption, like absorption. As well as the ABG will show a normal DO2 in these patients because the levels of carbon monoxide.
So we should keep using minimum peak of
from 5 centimeters to 6 feet, and we consider the use of incremental FIR to deep formations like short and deep to achieve the best. So this is a distributed approach of a low peak, higher FIR to formation, and start with a low FIR to 1 feet and a peak of 5. And you do this till you can totally FIR to 1.
Thank you.
transformative. The patients who require a peak of more than 10 centimeters for the tissue are afraid of more than 60%. The rate of pain and the result of more than 90% are the candidates for the process. For most of the patients who are not COPD, or other non-destructive for hyperreactive surgery, they are like, what we have to do, so it's 65%. For the patients who are just for deformity disorder, neuromuscular disorders. We should be there for target saturation level of 88 to 90%. And for patients with a prior hyperreactive failure history, this represents that low concentration of these patients should be higher. With an initial target of saturation 88 to 90%. Then you should avoid excess oxygen in patients with COPD because you can not cover. You basically have to use PCO2 to increase the loss of hydroxyl when they are in the following year, the LT version of PH and PCO2 are often in COPD. You can aim for an hydroxyl saturation from 94 to 98. And the blood gases should be repeated. And if the patient is hypercapnic and aspirated, we should consider starting the patient on NIV with a target symptomatic respiratory acidosis for more than 30 minutes without the decision of the starting dose. Pulmonary person. Most patients with the suspected pulmonary person usually has a normal sensitivity. Even if it is required, you can start with a lower concentration of oxygen to target for 90% to 90%. But in patients with a muscular pulsion, they don't have a profoundly altered hypoxia. You should initially give a high concentration of oxygen with a reservoir mass to achieve target saturation of 90% to 90%. And patients requiring mechanical ventilation, you keep a low caliber, low respiratory pressure and low heat because these concentrations are used for the right ventral nerves. And the main focus of the treatment is to reach a specific diagnosis and to start the antibiotic. Asthma patients also have some more patients. Asthma patients also require a target saturation of 94 to 98%. And should remember that excess oxygen can also have a hypercapnic state of care. And supplementary oxygen should be started using an acid camera. But you can for a single face mask with the final product. And pneumonia also, so say, keep a target of 94 to 98. Then exit separation of 65 hours. It is recommended that the patient with the exit separation of 65 hours should be managed.
Moderate, the temperature is
92 to 98.
less than
90 to 94.
And severe
saturation falls to
less than 90.
So your respiratory the rate increase will be according. Next, mild cases, you stay at home and take all your dawakar. Okay, no need of oxygen. Moderate case, how much oxygen should you give? Do you need to give oxygen?
Yes.
So moderate cases of COVID, get admitted and you give oxygen. You start at the basic. You start with, unless the patient is in shock and in distress, you don't attach NRT. Right? The patient is just 90 to 95, you start with
nasal pulse.
Nasal cannula, Hudson mask, NRTM, and then we see how he's tolerating and you escalate to
NIV or HFM.
Correct? And if the patient comes straight away with severe, then you don't waste time tapping on nasal
cannula. HFNC or
directly you attach NRBMNC where the patient is tolerating or he requires an escalation in the oxygen therapy. Okay, next. So you have to follow the ARDS-NET protocol even in COVID patients. What is the goal of oxygenation in ARDS protocol? You have to maintain how much PaO2? 55 to 80, right? You have to do everything. Either you give oxygen by your ventilator or your HFNC or your NIV, but I need that PaO2 between 55 to 80 or saturation of 88 to 92%. Right? When you follow ARDS-NET protocol, what should be your plateau pressures? Less than
30.
To achieve that plateau pressure less than 30, maybe you have to play around with your tidal volume. So how much is the lowest tidal volume acceptable in ARDS-NET protocol?
4 ml.
That's very less. Okay, we don't do so less. You have to be very vigilant. You have to have a nurse to a patient ratio of everything. But 6 ml/kg, you can definitely try to get down. What are the problems with low ventilation, low tidal volume?
Hypercapnia.
Yes, hypercapnia. So ARDS-NET says that I can allow hypercapnia going up to
60 to 70
is allowed, but it's very difficult. Okay, you have to start escalating the tidal volume the moment the plateau pressures go less than 30. Now plateau pressure is different from peak pressure. Okay, we have all the setting on the ventilator. There's a PIP, there's a P-plat. Okay. So you have to go on to the plateau pressure and keep checking every 1 hour or 2 hours. Give the kya hai. Accordingly, you have to maintain. You can either use pressure control or you can use volume control, either assist or properly control ventilation. Correct? Most of the time, ARD patient needs to be totally knocked off, sedated, paralyzed, and recruitment maneuver should be on all the time. Right? Next. Okay, next. So, in worsening conditions, we intubate the patients. Next. So, I'll say next. What is the maximum peak that can be given to the patient?
18 to 24.
Yeah. So, what happens when you give more peak? Definitely can't go very fast on the peak, especially if the patients are unstable on anaerobic support. So there you play around with higher FiO. If the patients are stable, then you play around with high peak and you can, you know, taper down your FiO. Right? COVID patients, whether it's mild, moderate or severe, we go in for chronic. Okay? Awake or intubated. Even if it's severe, intubated or NIV patients, chronic is definitely the goal. Next.
So, this is the objective of the
levels higher than those at one atmosphere pressure. And it has benefits like it promotes healing, it promotes the phagocytosis and antibiotic action on the microorganisms or organisms. And it also results in vascular constriction, thus increasing the tissue. And it also increases the RBA pressure, which increases the interstitial tissue pressure, thus it can be used to treat the conditions in the disease type. The indications for metabolic syndrome are the different symptoms, aerobes, gas sanguine, and other products in the metabolic monster, congenital and acute condition of the taxes, and also for the complications of metabolic syndrome, not only the paradigma, but most commonly of the disease.
Why are you not leaving? I know. Why are you not leaving?
And nuclear process to process in my opinion. Nuclear can act for
so the dynamic of the maturity, what is the target oxygenation you are in? 91 to 95. What is the target oxygenation in COPD patients?
88 to 98.
For the rest of the patients?
94 to 98.
But carbon monoxide poisoning?
100%.
Right, keep as much oxygen as possible. Okay?
Keep pressing.
Okay.
So there is a compressor over here. The piston is going to compress the air. The compressed air will be warm and obviously the compressed air will get warmer. Okay, as this piston compresses the air. So now this air will be made to pass through the liquid nitrogen, which is a way to cool the air down. The liquid nitrogen will have a temperature of minus 150 degrees Celsius. So this cools the air down, whatever compressed air we have. This compressed air will be sent to another tank, which will have, since the cool air will have different components of air, so the carbon dioxide gets separated out in this tank. And from this tank, we will be going to another tank, which will help the air to expand. So basically, these are the types of chambers which will come from where, if the air goes from one chamber to other, the different types, different components of air get separated. So here, we will have a separate CO2. From here, this is an expanding chamber, from which the rest of the components of air starts getting separated. And then we have a distillation process. In the distillation process, the air is heated up for a time. So once the air starts heating up, we have something called a critical temperature. At a particular critical temperature of particular air, the air starts separating out. So we have critical temperature of nitrogen, which is different from oxygen, which is different from argon. So that's how at a particular temperature we get a different components of air. That's how we collected and used it for our purpose. So this method is used for getting 99.9% pure oxygen. But this method and these plants are highly expensive. So that's why we have more of PSA plants as compared to cryogenic plants. So this is one of the picture of the cryogenic plant. That's how it is. The cryogenic plant is more superior because of fractional distillation, but the cost of putting in cryogenic plant is. So now this was all about the production of the oxygen. Now the oxygen gets transported in big cylinders from the place of manufacture to the hospital, and from there it is stored in different forms. Either it can be stored in gaseous form or in liquid. If it is stored in gaseous form, it will be either in cylinder or manifold cylinder gas system. And if it is stored in a liquid form, it is called as vacuum insulated evaporator. Okay. So the cylinder forms is the very basic form which we come across in. These are the types of the cylinder, the capacity and pressure. The most common one is the E1, which we use daily in the anesthesia with the anesthesia machine. The E1 has a capacity of 660 with a pressure of 1900 psi. And then there is another type of cylinder which are G and H. These are the types of cylinder which we use for jumbo cylinders. We use that for manifolds. I will be coming on to manifold later on. The M type of cylinder is the one which we use.
This is a transport cylinder. The one that we use for transporting the patient.
E.
E to apna machine ke niche hai.
F.
Ambulance.
F is the ambulance. N is the type of cylinder which we use for transport of the patient. Now, how would you get to which type of cylinder?
M. I don't know.
M बहुत बड़ा है.
अपना एक अभी मैं transport ventilator का cylinder क्या है? It's not E. E is what we keep
behind the machine. Behind the machine.
X, G or M is AK.
So X is the cylinder which is kept in the front of the ambulance. So what is the difference?
M bhi to bahut bada hai. 3500.
The base is E, have to work with this cylinder. We have to do one case with that cylinder. So according to the pressure in the cylinder, we can find out how many hours that cylinder is going to last. So we have a calculation for that. So there is a volume of oxygen available in the cylinder that we are going to find out. So we use a oil flow. P1 equals to P2. P1 is pressure in the cylinder, which is read on the pressure tube. While P1 is the volume of cylinder in the water capacity. While P2 is the atmospheric pressure, which is 1 kg per centimeter square. And P2 is the required value to be wanted, the volume of oxygen in the cylinder to the pressure. So now let's take an example. Suppose this is the cylinder that the pressure gauge shows 90 kg per centimeter. So it shows 90 kg per centimeter square. Okay, so the P type of cylinder. The water capacity. Now for that you have to look at the water capacity of each cylinder. So the P type of cylinder is 10 liters. So the volume of the oxygen in the cylinder would be 90 into 10 to 1. 90 is the pressure given, 10 is the water capacity. And then 1 is the atmospheric pressure. Same way for the D type of cylinder, we have 110. Now within this D type of cylinder, we have shown the pressure capacity is showing 110 kg per centimeter square. So the volume will be 5.7 liters. Okay. So after that, we have another formula for duration of oxygen in the cylinder. That is time and energy equals to pressure minus residual pressure into oxygen and fluid. So pressure is the whatever pressure we have right now. The residual pressure is the safe pressure to avoid running out of oxygen. So usually we consider it 5 to 3 kg per centimeter square. And constant is specific for every cylinder by which we have to learn. A type is 5, B type is 10, C type is 40, D type is 47. And the flow rate is the flow rate whichever flow rate we are giving the oxygen, like 4 liters, 5 liters, whatever. Right. So, that's the whole equation we can be using. So, this is an example that this is a cylinder with a pressure of 90 kg per centimeter square, with a flow rate of 5 liters per minute. Okay. So, now, according to the type of cylinder, we can find out how long it's going to last. Like for type A, it's going to last for 1 hour 10 minutes using the same formula. Type B is going to last for 2 hours, type C 10 hours, type D 10 hours, whatever. So using all these methods, you have to learn a lot of things like the constant, water capacities and everything. So there is an alternative method to find out the time. So alternative method is time and energy using pressure and energy into the initial volume divided by initial pressure. Using this method, you don't have to buy out everything and you can actually find the number of hours in the class. So for an E type of cylinder, the ratio is 1200 PSI. So that is very important. 2000 is the initial pressure. So that is
after. First, you have to check the cylinder, how much pressure is there, and how much time. This is an easy form. Remember this formula and they will ask you also an exam now. Everything related to oxygen is only what comes in your paper. COVID and oxygen.
The next one is the another type of storage of oxygen, which is the liquefied, that's how we store the liquefied oxygen. It's called vacuum insulated evaporator. So we would have seen all these.
Have you all seen? We have seen the oxygen tank in that one. How many we have? Yeah, one.
That's
very bad.
Huh?
That's a question. How many have? We have two. We have three, four. Kitna oxygen tank it has?
One.
Only one.
What building ke piche hai? What building ke piche hai?
Iske piche?
What building ke backside building?
In front of beans, okay. And the other one? And the third one? Nobody has seen only second one. Where is the second one? You said two, na? So where is the second one? I see. So, the other one is gone. near the ego or head word? Whoever is an ego word, who's an ego word? Ego word ke piche hai itna bada tank.
Keyboard के पीछे भी biomedical waste का है ना?
Office is a toilet,
ना? वहाँ biomedical waste का है keyboard के पीछे. वहाँ पे oxygen.
Near the keyboard.
Okay, so vacuum insulated evaporator. Basically, it is a huge cover of glass which is so liquid oxygen. It is used in large hospitals where the oxygen requirement is too much, like more than 300 liters per second, more than 7 liters per second. 1 liter of liquid oxygen is 40 liters of gaseous oxygen. Okay. So this is used basically it's going to help us in storing more oxygen at the resistance. So these type of these evaporators have two shells. One is the inner shell, one is the outer shell. The inner shell is made up of stainless steel, but the outer shell is made up of carbon. Okay. And the oxygen that is stored in that inside this the pressure inside the oxygen is going to be 1000 kilopascal with a temperature at minus 50 degrees Celsius. So why it is important is
minus
150 degrees Celsius. So now the oxygen gets stored in this pressure. Now whenever there is a use of oxygen, the balance, okay, it is a self-regulating type of system. So they have got two types of valves. One is the pressure raising valve, and then there is another one which is pressure increasing valve. So in the very hot weather or the temperature where the temperature of the liquid oxygen is too high, and or in cases where the oxygen requirement is too much, in such cases pressure inside the container is bound to increase too much, and there is a high risk of the whole container to burst out. So what happens is they have a valve which is called as a blow-off valve. So this blow-off valve has a capacity pressure of 1500 kilopascals. So when the pressure reaches to that level, it opens up. So that there is some release of motivation from this side and it will go to your system. Okay. And in cases, especially in cases which has like extreme winter conditions, is going to be low. So we have pressure increasing valves, pressure rising valves over here. They will increase the pressure of the container and go to 1000 kilopascals so that it will go to the system. So basically it is a self-regulating type of system. So from here the O2 passes to the pressure regulatory valve which will decrease the whole pressure of the system to 400 kilopascals. And from there it can go to a central system. That's how the whole system.
What's the pipeline pressure, the oxygen? Now 60 to 65. What is the pressure at the end of the machine, at the output of an anesthesia machine?
45.
Then there is going to be so bad a problem. Lash. It's not. By the time it comes out, it's 5 to 10 PSI. That's the low pressure that we get at the outlet, at the mask. When you press flush, it is around 30 to 35. What is in the pipeline is 60. What is in the cylinder is 2000.
High pressure system.
So 2060. Then it comes down, regulates, down. What comes out is 5. Okay?
Over here, the end of the system has a pressure of 400.
Low maxilla. PSI ki kitna hai, convert hi nahi kiya. Nobody knows. Convert and see how much PSI is there. For people who have not seen, what is the capacity of this tank? Now that will be the next line. What is the capacity of this tank?
So the capacity of the tank is 13 tons.
1 ton is how much?
1000 kgs.
No, 1 metric ton or 1 ton is 7 lakh liters of gaseous oxygen. इतना है अपने पास oxygen capacity. 13 into 7 lakhs. And why that much is required? That also she will tell you.
So for a daily, in a 24-hour requirement of oxygen, 1 metric ton equals to 35 patients per day for normal ward patients. So daily for 24 hours, requirement of oxygen, 1 metric ton equals to 35 patients per day for normal ward patients. Then we use oxygen at 5 to 6 liters per day. While 1 metric ton equals to 9 patients per day for ICU patients.
But 1 metric ton, this is a rough calculation. 1 metric ton is around 7 lakh liters of gaseous oxygen. Okay? So imagine how much lakhs of oxygen in gaseous form is there in that tank of ours. And the daily requirement would be around 6 metric tons in Sion hospital.
The third type of system for O2 storage is manifold cylinder gas system. Basically, this is the type of system we use as a backup. Or it can be used as a primary system for the supply of oxygen.
Jumbo cylinders and Europlastic. Who is there in Europlastic? You have seen that size of the cylinder, that is jumbo.
This type of system is being used in for nitrous actually in our hospital. So a manifold cylinder has two bags which are at least G size, at least 10, which contain at least 10 G size cylinders. Both the bags have different, they are set up with different pressures. There is a outlet regulator of the bag which is set at 700 kilopascal. The outlet regulator of the second bag is set at 550 kilopascal to prevent that from being used. So basically first bag gets used up and after that the second bag gets used. So because of the pressure difference, the second one does not start getting used until the first one gets used. This is how the manifold cylinder gas system is. Now, moving on to the supply of oxygen. From here, the oxygen gets supplied in a pipeline, like it is distributed in pipelines. So the pipeline for supply, the pipeline for the supply of oxygen extends from DIA manifold cylinders via copper piping to the filter and other protocols. We have got three types of pipeline. One is mains pipe, which is from the source. The second one is called risers, which are vertical pipe rising from the mains. And the third one are the branches or the lateral lines that service a room or a room of use. So this is the mains type of pipeline. So the mains type of pipeline, which is rising from the source directly. These are the risers, which are basically arising from the mains. And the lateral one. Branches which are arriving, which are in the room, and they finally end up in a terminal room or the where people are going. So the other parts of the pipeline, we have got two types of valves. There is a service shutoff valve and a manual type of or the zonal type of shutoff valve. So the service shutoff valve is the one which is taken care by the mobilized personnel. Basically, these are the valves which are used to if something has to be repaired, we can use these valves to shut off the supply of the oil. So the service shutoff and the manual one is for the emergency service shutoff. The installation, you know, it is installed in a box with a removable lid. So this is the main shutoff valves which we might have seen. This is the type of shutoff which we see every day in SOP.
deliver only from 5 to 10 liter. It can deliver more. Okay? Another advantage is that it is available at Desai. So if you want to move and there is no oxygen pipeline, you can just get an oxygen at home. You know, and in all these COVID care centers where there is not enough oxygen, they get an oxygen concentrator. It is a very small, like a suitcase. Size of a mini suitcase which you carry on, carry on the flight, that's
I want to my last slide. We always, we were looking at the news and everything that there is an efficiency of oxygen and everything. So we wanted to know why the oxygen crunch happened. So the demand of medical oxygen in pre-COVID times was around 700 metric tons per day.
This is all in India.
Yes, while the demand during the second day was 6,600. So there was a drastic increase while the daily production capacity, including the industrial use of oxygen, used to be 7,127 metric per day. So that is why it was difficult for us to procure oxygen.
See, metric ton will multiply to 7 lakhs,
okay,
this number. So our oxygen in our hospital requirement must be around 6 metric tons. We have a tank of 30. Daily filling has to happen. So daily filling can be, I think, around 3 or each tank. Go from there. That is how much comes. How much is the daily filling? The daily filling could be around 3 MT, not more than that. So the truck has to keep coming 3 times. If you want to fill up the whole tank, that is the oxygen used.
Right. And how, the
one
trying to fix it? By, they are implementing more of 550, they are planning of bed more 551 CNG plants to meet the current oxygen demand. And also we have biggest manufacturer of oxygen inox air production products which manufacture 60% of total country's total oxygen supply. And
so we must buy the shares now.
And also the country also started importing oxygen, around 15,000 metric tons of oxygen. And similarly, the PSA plant has been, like BMC has set up for
PSA. You know, there's a PSA plant in Sion Hospital?
Yeah.
Where is the location? Homework.
BMC has set up two PSA plants now, and they are planning to set up for one is at Kasturba Hospital, other one is at Trauma Hospital, locationally, and the third one is in Sion Hospital.
It's about the kitchen.
That's how
the
try to
do. So that one PSA plant will just be giving oxygen to one ward. It's not a lot of plant, but it will be giving only sufficient to one ward. Maybe one MT will be come for you. Webinars, or you want offline, all of you, whoever is not here also.